It's great to have you both with us. So I will give the floor to you so we can start right on time. And hopefully everybody will enjoy your presentation. But I guess they will, because it's amazing what you guys will be going to talk about.
Okay, you just let me know when I can give a short introduction about this, and then when I will start screen sharing.
Yes, you can start, Derek. I will. Yeah, you can start right now.
Okay. Welcome everyone. My name is Dirk Paulink. Next to me is Professor Rudy Arnoud from the European Commission. We will be talking today about some very important topics in European PropTech, especially in the fields of financing it. And I would like to start, if you're okay with that, immediately with the presentation that we have prepared for you.
Yes, that is working, Derek. It's coming up right now.
Yes, it always takes a moment. All right. Is this good, Walter?
Yeah, but I also see your next slide. Maybe you can change the display settings.
Okay.
So it gets a little bit bigger in. No, I think. Yeah, that one.
I'm sorry. This one. Is this good, Walter?
Yes, this is good. This is amazing.
Okay. All right. I'm very sorry for that. It's always a bit improvising. Right. Let's start right away. For the audience, why is PropTech a priority for Europe and also for the European Commission? Several factors, amongst them the macroeconomic trends that put pressure on returns and efficiency, data and technology that drive new needs of end users, real estate as a 217 trillion market still largely undigitized, and of course, and that's the most important thing that we are talking about here today, is the EU Green Deal and EU Next Generation, which are the most advanced climate action programs worldwide. So when we look at what is affecting European real estate, we have, first of all, the global trends that are impacting real estate, the macroeconomic trends, climate change, of course, rising urban development, specifically for Europe, the aging of the population, and then the more complex projects that that require more technology. Second term of trends are the technologies that are impacting real estate. I will talk about it in a minute, which is the AI, IoT, blockchain, for which is a subject that the European Commission is highly interested in, and they have even a separate department for it. So when we look at the major drivers of innovation in real estate, we always talk about user experience and efficiency. And when we put them then together here, we try to put here together the five most important in the future for us, which are like blockchain, 5G, AI, IoT, and VR, blockchain, especially transparency, financial stability, which is something that the European Commission also finds very, very important. And it also will bring, for example, efficiency in transactions and valuation. So I will not go into the details of all the other categories, but let's say that these ones are really on top of the agenda when we talk PropTech here in Europe and with the Commission. It's better to look also, before I start talking about innovation, is to how are we preparing for the future here in Europe. And then we see, for example, that 87% of real estate companies have now decided to increase spending in PropTech solutions within the next 12 months. At the same time, when you look at the R&D sector, now you see that 10% of revenue on tech firms is spent versus 1% of revenue in real estate firms. We see also that only 58% of real estate companies have already a digital strategy, with 95% have already hired the employee or the senior person responsible for the implementation. And then, in the end, why are companies adopting PropTech? Well, first of all, for improved efficiency, and then also for cost reduction and more efficient decision making. And what is holding us back, especially here, so also in Europe, is that there's not always a clear understanding of the ROI. Other strategic priorities, that's 40%, and then also a lack of talent. Now, innovation in Europe, specifically for PropTech, has taken really huge steps in the last, I would say, 2 years. And one of the things that I would like to talk about here for you, highlight, is the unique collaboration between the PropTech community in Europe by the PropTech Association and the European Space Agency. While we have there a specifically designed program, it's the PropTech Kickstart program that runs for European PropTechs that are developing services that can exploit technologies that have been developed within the framework of the European Space Agency. So not only funding by the European Space Agency, but also support from the Space Agency. And it goes from 64K in the starting period to, when we develop this further, possibility to have zero equity co-funding up to 50% with a maximum of 2 million euros. So these technologies, Wouter, that have been developed within the framework of the Space Agency, like global navigation satellite systems and Earth observation, how can we now use this into PropTech? We can use it for positioning information of users that navigate augmented reality applications. We can also use it to retrieve data from the Internet of Things devices that are deployed in the fields. We can use it to monitor microscopic construction activity. So all of this, we will be talking about that very soon. I will announce that. But if you doubt about why is this so important, so unique, this European Space Agency, well, look at this chart where you see that on the top right corner, automated valuation, smart building, urban mobility, drones, data analytics, and mapping in geospace are all the sectors where an enormous amount of funding goes to. I will give a free webinar with the European Space Agency October 9th to follow the European PropTech Association for details about that. Now, this is not the only way that the European Commission is helping. We have here developed specifically for PropTech startups and scale-ups programs such as the Fast Track to Innovation program, where you can have up to 3 million of grants by the European Commission. And the goal is there to get a fast track to innovation, so to reduce the time from idea to market. It is specifically designed for those startups that can go together with like two or three major real estate firms and then apply for funding for a very specific program that you need to enter into the European Commission. Another program that we have at the Commission is the European Innovation Council Accelerator Program. It's like for single startups or SMEs, you can get between 0.5 up to 2.5 million euros and even up to 15 million euros per scale up in extra funding. So these are things, Walter, that I find extremely important. And I can tell you that the PropTechs are not using it as they should or they could. So there's a lot of things to be discovered there. Let's not forget the EU Innovation Fund for complex real estate projects that combat gas emission. Large-scale projects can receive up to 7.5 million. So it's incredible. There are two deadlines to submit those proposals, 29th of October 2020 and June 23rd in 21. Very interesting, all of that. And what will now boost all of that? Well, two things. The European Green Deal and what we call EU Next Generation. And EU Green Deal, I'm sure that everyone has heard about it. It's about, when we talk about real estate in it, you need to know that real estate is responsible for 38% of emissions, 44% of energy consumption. So we need to do something with that within the framework of the European Green Deal. So therefore, a sustainable infrastructure window in InvestEU has been foreseen with the aim to double the annual renovation stock of our buildings. At this moment in Europe, we are renovating our existing building at a rate of between 0.4 and 1.2%, depending on the country. We need to more than double this. And of course, you need money for that. And this money will come from certain financial mechanisms within the EU Green Deal. And then we have Next Generation, which is in fact another program with a 1.85 trillion euros to boost the economy in the Eurozone, and of which 25% of the budget will be spent on climate investments and additional funding for Horizon Europe. So this is important for all the PropTechs in Europe, because there's a lot of money that will be available to do all those projects, not only for the PropTech companies, of course, Walter, but also for real estate in general, because in the end, we need to finance these things. So why is PropTech now a priority for the Commission? Well, EU Green Deal, EU Digital are the top two priorities right now for the Commission. And European PropTech is at the crossroads of both, because we combine green with digital. And therefore, PropTech is at the top of the agenda of the institutions. And that's all. The mission of the European PropTech Association is to help design and implement certain elements of this EU Green Deal into real estate. I would say follow us if you want to know more about that. The European PropTech Association itself is 24 national networks with 2,700 EU-based startups and scale-ups members here representing them. And of course, a very rich European PropTech ecosystem. The goals of the European PropTech Association is to standardize the market, to create a legal framework adapted to PropTech, to facilitate access to funding, scale up cross-border collaboration, and of course, working on future legislation. So what do we do? What do we do as steps? Well, one of the first was the PropTech Startup Europe Awards, promoted also by the European Commission, for which you can apply as from October the 1st, 2020. With a lot of jury members, I would say like the most of known here on this slide. And then how did we structure it? Well, you see that there's a lot of entities that are in a stellar configuration around the European PropTech Association. And all of that is driving the future of PropTech in Europe. Now, when we look at funding for PropTech, we see that in Europe specifically, in 2018, 1.5 billion has been invested. In 2019, it was already 3.05 billion, and we expect that 185 billion will be deployed in PropTech before 2025, in a general way of speaking. The number of deals, Wouter, are going down, but the funding in total is going up. Why is PropTech now also, from that point, interesting for Professor Arnold and his team? Is that PropTech is still early, because the majority of the PropTechs has less than 500k funding, the majority has less than 5-10 FTEs, and the majority is in a validation stage, which is like the moment to be investing in. When you look then at the general trends per segment, you see that the markets or the segments of manage and operate, and especially market and transact, are really crowded. Another important one here to mention is that VC investments as a percentage of GDP have been increasing in almost all the EU countries. When you look at this slide, in the yellow, these are the figures of 2019, and the red lines are the annual averages from 2015 to 2019. This is very interesting. So Walter, I'm here again with a positive outlook for European PropTech, which is because at this moment, it's right that EU startups and scale-ups are tied to the internal EU market performance. We have liquidity challenges, but at the same time, companies are improving readiness of infrastructure. Then the ones with cash will even invest more, and the investors, current investors, will not let their invested startups or scale-ups fail. Add to that, in the end, that COVID-19 accelerates the need for public solutions, and I think that we have a bright future. So for us, investment in European PropTech will remain high. For those who are able to act in the short term, ensure that there's a quick implementation of the solutions that they propose, create a fast ROI, and of course, collaboration within the same geography. And then in the end, align with the EU Green Deal and Next Generation EU. When the Relevation Fundraising Summit was organized earlier this year, there was something very specific that we noticed. There was only 23% of the investors had 100% dedicated focus on PropTech. So we foresee that this is positive, because from 2020 onwards, you will see generalist VCs investing more and more in a specific PropTech fund rather than creating their own new teams and gaining in-house experience. And before I let Professor Arnold now explain how he's going to finance all of this, I want to share a last thing with you, which is a sign of a maturing PropTech industry here in Europe, is that 50% of the funding at this moment is at the later stages. And this is a specific pain point in Europe. I think that a lot of the PropTechs that are listening here today know that. And then we come to talk about specifically the scale-up gap. And the scale-up gap is really the specialty of Professor Rudy Arnold.
Thank you, Dirk. First of all, I would like to congratulate Global PropTech with this initiative. And PropTech is still a young movement. It's very important. So it's good to put on the picture and to do seminars about it. And I heard the last statement of Alexander. She said, technology is just a tool. Well, I couldn't agree more. But I would say for PropTech, technology is a tool to shake the world and to shake the real estate world. And there, one of my economists I like quite a lot, he's European, not an American, his name is Schumpeter. He said, we have to destroy the old and introduce new equilibrium. Destroy the old might be dan real estate. And the new might be the smart real estate. And smart real estate is a combination of real estate with artificial intelligence, virtual reality, Internet of Things, big data, blockchain, and so on. And that's in fact what PropTech is about. It's about combination of things. So I would agree with my friend Dirk, there's a huge and very nice future for PropTech. And this huge we cannot miss. So let's have a look what is happening in the world that makes that PropTech is now on top of the agenda. Well, what are the game changers? The first game changer is the crisis. We all know what happened with COVID. Crisis from the Greek kinomai means taking decisions. Well, we have new views on mobility. Before we accepted that we were every morning 1 hour in the traffic jam, the same in the evening. We don't accept anymore. We want to go online. We want to think about co-working spaces. And Dirk knows very well about this thing. We think about the local dimension. So I think this crisis is a very relevant moment for PropTech to take decisions. The second point, digital. Digital becomes the new normal. It's no longer something marginal. And then if you look, and I will show you in 1 second the slide, that for the real estate, there is still a long way to go. It's a long way to Tipperary, as they say. Third element, real estate guys, if you speak about them, what is the value of a business? They say there are three parameters. It's location, location, location. I would say this is no longer the truth. It's accessibility, it's mobility. So I think the old storage houses, which are at the border of the city centers, they will gain in value. And of course, green becomes the mainstream. Now, let me come back to my second point about digitalization. And if you look on digitalization, and then you see, in fact, different elements linked to real estate, then you see that real estate is not the champion of digitalization. You have something, if you look at the different elements concerning real estate, you have something like 10 to 12%, and other sectors like computer, tourism, are much more digitalized. So the first thing, the first message from me to you today, in name of the Commission, please, let's focus on digitalization, and this is the core business of PropTech. And secondly, Dirk says we have something like 2,700 startups and scale-ups. I would say that mainly startups. And what we are looking for is scale-ups. And if you see, and this is of course for somebody working at the Commission, a very frustrating slide, that most of the unicorns, they are in the United States and they are in China. So what we need in Europe is that those potential of startups will be translated into scale-ups. If you look, for instance, at the States, about 100 startups are translated to 22 scale-ups. In Europe, it's an average, it's 11. So let's look what we should do in the future and how this works. Of course, I'll give you an example of WeWork, which might perhaps not be the best example of a scale-up today, but last year they were the biggest figure and they had the big value, which is now reduced quite a bit, by the way. Now, why do we not have startups? Why do we not have scale-ups? We have startups, why do we not have all the scale-ups? Well, the first point, of course, the mindset, and we want the Europeans to grow. And so we'd ask Walter and your whole team, let's in PropTech look at growth potential. And secondly, scaling up means that we need money. And if you look at the compared United States with Europe, especially on later stage, that we have a problem on lacking scale-up money. And where is our problem in financing? Because let's be honest, if you cannot find the money, you have a problem. Well, the first problem is it's easy to find 50,000, 100,000, 500,000. But then the first problem is you need 1 million to 3 million. What do you call the first equity gap? Okay, if you get through that, you have a lot of form of venture capital, especially in the Netherlands. You have a lot of funds. But then you're looking for 15 to 25 million, which means a problem. And once you're dead, you want to go public. So we can summarize that we have three problems in the field of financing, where we want to cope a lot. Now, you might say, but there is a lot of money. What are you talking about? Well, there is a lot of money, but look how many companies do leave Europe in the scale-up phase because they don't find the money here. An average VC fund in Europe has a fund of 65 million euro. A fund of 65 million euro cannot put 25 million euro into one company. So therefore, we have a scale-up problem, and we have what we call a scale-up gap. 44% of the companies in Europe that have been starting here, that got innovation support, we are leaving. So we should try to avoid that. On the other hand, we should not say that the solution is to put public money in the market, because there is not lack of money. There's a lack and a problem of transmission towards scale-up. This, of course, is a danger of crowding out. So we should do something on digital, we should do something on green, and if you combine green, digital and financing, we have sustainable growth. Everything went well, and there came that virus who made that world collapsed, the economic world. But things are now getting better, and we say in Europe, we should do something about it. The first thing we do about it is the recovery. And Dirk was speaking about next generation. We have already the program of SURE, which in fact helps people, which is already next generation will be decided in the council normally this week. And we have the multi-financial framework, which is now 1.74 billion, so it's a lot of money. To give you an idea, this is 12% of the GDP. I would to ask all people listening to me, do you know the Marshall Plan, the big one, United States? How much percent was that of the GDP? It was 1.5%. So we are speaking about huge amounts of money. Now, this money is about recovery. And if you speak about recovery, we speak about the green recovery, meaning green is not an obstacle to economy. Green should be a partner of the economy. And so it will be green, digital health. This will be what you want to do in the future. And are you concerned in PropTech? Well, have a look yourself. If I give you some examples of what you want to do in the field of energy, in the field of digital, each of them has a link with PropTech. So I would say PropTech is really on the center of what you want to do. So don't miss the boat together. And I know that Eurocrats always have the impression that it makes things difficult. And I must tell you, you're right. So we try to make things simple for the future. You know all these programs. I think you heard about FC, you've heard about COSME, Innofin, etc., etc. Well, the good news is, ladies and gentlemen, we're all going to put them in the litter. Finished. We don't want those programs anymore. And we're going to put them into one big program, which is called InvestEU. So InvestEU is going to be the one program who is going to aggregate all financial instruments done at European level. This InvestEU then will be broken up into five windows. The first window is this infrastructure window. I look at the right of my slide. Research and development window, the SME window, the social window, and the strategic window. Again, each of these windows has a link with PropTech, and you could in fact be eligible for each of these windows. Will then be implemented through European Investment Bank, through European Investment Fund, or through any financial institution or national promotion bank. These amounts are not definitive because they are in discussion in the council. And you see sustainable infrastructure research, SME, social investment and skills is there. I put strategic European investment in red because for the moment it is not decided because the council was quite negative. So if you want to do some lobbying, it's the right moment this week to keep the strategic European investment. If not, it will be in the fall or the window. So it's a nice thing to do the lobbying now. Now, I spoke about the scale-up financing, that this is the real issue. And if we get scale-up financing, we might have at every window. And it was already something difficult before the crisis. But as you can see, and this is a study based on what will be the impact of Corona on financing, that you see the Serie B plus, that's exactly where the cash burn will be very hard to manage. So it's really a big problem, but we might have some shortage in Europe on this scale up phase. That's why we invented a new program, which is called Escalar. Escalar means European Scale Up Action Plan. Escalar will be implemented by the Commission, financed by the Commission, financed by InvestEU, which I just explained to you, where we have the idea that we want to double the investment capacity of venture capital funds. So if you have a venture capital fund, imagine a fund of 50 million, which is private money, public money combined. On top of that, and this is very innovative, we're going to double the capacity, adding 50 million. But this million will not be equity, but quasi-equity. So for the experts amongst you, it will be a return that is capped, but in case of failure, the commission will be paid back first. So we have something like quasi-equity, which means that there will be not only a leverage on volume of the fund will not only get bigger, but the equity players for a good fund will have higher return. So the idea is that this would allow venture capital funds to more to facilitate the investment, the raising of capital of equity, and on top of that, have the quasi-equity we want. This is part of what we call today, it's a buzzword, or it's a sexy word, the blending of financial instruments. So you see an example, you could have 30%, which will be equity, you could have KfW, BPI, whatever, public fund, and we have, on top of that, we raise 50 million through the Escala fund. For those who are not annoyed by my speech now, listen 1 minute very carefully. The idea would in fact be that due to Escala, as the Escala return is capped, it means that return for LPs will have a positive leverage. So this means that LPs who accept to have quasi-equity into their fund will have higher return, and that's of course the main issue. Let me finish by some personal conclusions on PropTech. First of all, the world is moving. As I said, location is no longer the issue. It's time and speed. Second, the Green Deal is a unique opportunity. Don't wait, because it's there. It will be there for the next 7 years, so please use it. Digitalization. In my view, PropTech and real estate to be the champion in this digitalization. So please, let's use that potential to see things positive. Scale up, as I told, it's high on the political agenda. And real estate, you're really the best place of all because you're on the edge of green and digital. So next time we speak about smart real estate, and smart real estate is nothing else than PropTech. So don't miss the momentum. And again, thank you for the organization. And see you all soon.
Hey, I have one question for you both. Just a short question. How can startups, scale-ups apply to get to these funds and to get to this money?
That's a very good question, Wouter. And very fortunately, we have here in the European PropTech Association headquarters, we have a team of 15 people. The company is called Finova, where we work with. People that also work a lot in the programs that we are talking about. And what they do, they give to the European startup scale-ups in PropTech, they give a free scan, they make a free scan of what the company is doing, technologies that are being used, and then they are going to look in which of the programs that we have been talking about, but there are many others, they could apply. What would be the best program to apply for, right? It could be the ESA program, it could be the Fast Track to Innovation I was talking about. There's a lot, quite some programs there. So we do a scan, it's a free scan, and then we, if they choose to apply for certain program, then this team of 15 people can help them in how to write the proposal that then can be submitted to the European Commission.
Cool. So when is there already money being invested in one of the PropTech companies, Rudy?
Well, PropTech as such is not recognized as a sector. You know, we know what PropTech is, but of course there are quite a lot of companies who gets money, you know, to do it, gets money through risk capital. Because if you say money, it's not only about subsidies. Subsidies, I think more and more we try to move from subsidies to financial engineering because this is better value for public money. But indeed, there are quite a lot of these funds that goes into these companies and goes into PropTech companies. Yes, they are.
I can tell you, Walter, in addition to that, that currently, the team is now engaged with 28 European PropTech startups where they have made the scan and they are looking at how to write the proposal to submit in one of the calls. In general way of speaking, in most of the cases in these programs, you have four times per year that you can submit a proposal and ask to be included in grants, as Professor Arnold says, but also in other ways of financing.
Cool. Well, thank you very much, both of you. Have a great day there in Belgium, and I hope to see you guys soon also in person. That would be great.
See you, Walter. It will happen soon. Thank you, Walter.
Thank you very much. Have a great day.
Thank you. Bye.